believeth to be those who were dead, yet shall live. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and shall stand in the latter day upon the earth. Though skin worms destroy this body, yet shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not as another one. You brought nothing into this world, and you certainly can carry nothing away. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You may be seated. We gather for the homegoing services of Brother Brenton Harding. Program will proceed as printed. We do solicit your prayers for this bereaved family. We do desire to glorify God in all that we do and say.
Testament is coming from Psalms 24. The earth is yours and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who may stand in his holy place? The New Testament, John 14, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, that you may be also. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the reading of the word.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come just thanking you for this day, Lord. Thank you for this family, Lord, that in their time of bereavement will be with them. And Lord, we pray for the father, the nephews, and the grandkids, dear Lord. Be with this family, dear Lord. And most of all, dear Lord, continue to bless them as they go through this day. In Jesus' name, and only in Jesus' name, do we pray. Amen.
He was over there in the wing.
Oh, he's in the room?
Yeah.
Y'all tear the door to come out here. Holding us up. I'm not one of those presiders that need to call everybody's name so when it's for time to appear. Please do so.
tribute, so they weren't aware that the DVD wouldn't be able to play here. So standing there now for the tribute, I woke up about 4 o'clock this morning and I said, I want to write a tribute to my son. And lo and behold, the video didn't play. So obviously this is my part, right? Today, December 1st, 2021. I'm reminded of a biblical passage in Hebrews 11, 13 through 14. It said, these all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar off, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and pilgrims on this earth, declaring plainly that they seek a country, a place not made with hands, but whose builder and maker is God. As your mother, I, along with a great cloud of witnesses, usher you into the heavenly host as a star in the realm of the kingdom of heaven, your new utopia. My son, I applaud you. And as we have often shared, Mom is your greatest friend. Master Brenton, they used to call him at the church. You are hereby kingdom bound. See you soon, my son, on the other side of glory.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's a new morning. Weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning.
Yes.
I am Pastor Mary Estrada. I'm one of Belita's good friends. And I was asked to read Psalm 91 because this was Brenton's favorite scripture. But I just want to piggyback on what you said on Hebrew 11. As I sat there, first I was sitting here, the Lord spoke to me and he said, Brenton was looking for a foundation for a city whose maker and foundations was God. God confirms his word by the mouth of two witnesses. Brenton, like Abraham, traveled not knowing, but he found his God, and he's now in the heavenly places, knowing that one day that we'll be there too with him. Psalm 91, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my God, in whom I will trust. And we know that was one thing about Brenton. He trusted in the Lord. Surely he shall deliver me from the snare of the fowler and from the noise of pestilence. He shall cover me with his feathers, and under his wings thou shalt trust, and he shall be thy shield and thy buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near thee. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. For thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. No evil shall befall thee, neither any plague shall come near thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, and keep thee in all thy way. They shall bear thee up, their hands, lest they a dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion, and the young lion, and the dragon, and thou shalt trample under the feet. Because he has set up the Lord, therefore, because he has set his love upon the Lord, therefore, the Lord will deliver him. He will set up on high, because he has known his name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. Glory. few minutes we'll talk about the subject of a sovereign source. Give praises to our God and to this bereaved family, to all of these persons who appeared on the program. We've been really blessed by your contributions, and we again solicit your prayers for this family that God would give them strength. I did not know Brenton personally, but we've heard some very positive tributes to him today, and thank God for his life. Listening to Trevor Noah this morning, he's one of my favorite characters. Trevor was talking about this new variant, the virus, that supposedly came out of South Africa. He made the point that the virus actually started in the Netherlands, but it was the researchers in South Africa that was smart enough to find out some of the intricacies, the details of the virus, and in an effort to try to inform the rest of the world, told us about the virus. Well, they didn't stop people from the Netherlands coming to the country. People started to ban folk from South Africa. The virus didn't start there, but they were the ones who reap the brunt of the punishment because they were trying to help the rest of the world. That's what happens a lot of times in life. People confuse the sources from people who are actually trying to help. We live in a very divided world. A lot of people have a difficulty getting along with one another. We've been divided by race, we're divided by educated, non-educated, we're divided by finance, rich, non-rich. There are a lot of places the devil seeks to divide us. But the truth of the matter is, we're all one people. That's what John was trying to say. He says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And when he says in the beginning, right, naturally it calls your mind to run to Genesis, which is in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. In fact, God created everything. All things come out of God. Life comes from God. Light, he says, comes from God. In him is light. God is the source of everything. So that there are some folks who have difficulty with that concept because, you know, there are some folks who don't even want to believe in God. Can't argue that point. I mean, you know, it's my life to share God. It's my life to talk about God. It's my life to brag on God. And so I do my thing. You do your thing. You do your thing. But the fact of the matter is that God is the source of all of it.
Yeah.
Whether or not they all come from God. He is our creator. It started with God. Mm-hmm. No sense in trying to debate about whether you're white or black, Jew or Gentile. It really doesn't matter because we all started in the same place.
Yeah.
We all have the same source. We all have the same beginning. We all need oxygen to breathe. We all need sunshine in order to survive. We all have a commonality. Our commonality is more important than our differences. And we need to come to grips with this fact that God is the source of life. Mm. Real life emanates from him. Real life comes from God. That you really can't know what life is until you know God.
Yeah.
And that's the problem with a lot of folks because they're so busy trying to discover life. And they're looking for life in all the wrong places. You don't find life in the Bible. You don't find it in drugs. You don't find life in a lot of places people are looking for it. Life really comes from him. And in order for me to know what life is all about, I need to go to the manual.
Yes.
He's the one. He's the one who gave life. You know, when you buy a new car, they give you a little manual with the car. And if you really want to know about the car, you go to the manual. And God has given us a manual to govern our lives by. And I need to know something about the manual if I want to know something about life, if I want to know something about God. God says, in the beginning was the Word. He spoke the world into existence. It was the Word of God. They said, let there be. It starts with God. You don't have to respect him. You don't have to acknowledge him. But the fact of the matter is, one day, you will have to stand before God.
Yeah.
You will have to acknowledge that God is God. So that to ignore him is really somewhat foolish. To ignore him is really to go through life with my blinders on. It's trying to suggest that I can go through life without knowing him who created life, who starts, who initiates life. He's the source of life.
Amen.
I have a problem with Christians who go around like they sucking on a lemon, like they sad. I have a problem with folks who come to church and they have sad church. Sometimes people come to church and act like it's a funeral every day. I don't understand you being sad. You lost a loved one. You lost somebody you care about. You're supposed to be sad, but you ought not look like that on a Sunday morning. When I walk in church on Sunday morning, I'll be somewhat like David was. He said, I was glad.
Oh, right.
Glad he woke me up this morning. I'll be glad that he started my morning. I'll be glad that I got my health and my strength. I should be glad that my life is extended. I should be glad that I have experienced love and know what love is and share love. And so if you share the love with Bethany Brenton, if you knew who he was, you ought to be glad that you had that opportunity, that your path crossed with his path. And hopefully something was gained by that meeting that brought you closer to God. But then I need to understand that God does not only give me life, he says he provides for me light. He provides for me light. It's an illumination. It's an illumination that it's real easy to go through life in darkness. You know, darkness, it covers a whole lot. He says the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Something like that means where you don't see the dark, you don't see the light in darkness. Well, that's kind of foolish. It's really kind of impossible to have real darkness and introduce light and not see it. I mean, you have just a little small candle in the corner. You might not see all of it, but when you light that candle, I guarantee you're going to see it. So he's not talking about not being able to comprehend it. He's talking about not being able to defeat it. Not being able to put the light out. Not being able to stop the light from illuminating. That's something about God. When I know God, that God not only gives me life, he gives me light. He lights up my life.
Right.
He makes my life worth living.
Right.
He's the one who provides joy to my life. Some of you have a significant other. You found somebody that really turns you on. That's a good thing. I feel glad for you. Celebrate that. And you know, the sad thing is when you really love somebody and they leave you, it leaves a void. It leaves a hole. But the good news about God is that he'll never leave you nor forsake. I am with you always. Even not until, but unto the end of the world. In other words, I don't stop it when you die. When you die, I'm still with you. Come on here, somebody. To the other side.
Lord.
That he's light. And I feel sorry for folk who are living in darkness. Some folk wake up depressed. Some folk wake up mean. Some folk wake up, just like so negative. They don't see anything positive out of life. They live in a gloom. They live with a cloud over their head. And that's a sign of somebody who really don't know God. And it's sad when church folk claim to be his children, claim to be his followers, and you go around like you don't know what joy really is.
Yeah.
It's like you hate no worldly people because they have a good time. Ain't no sense you hate no folk because they like to party. I tell my folk all the time, I like to party too. I want to have a party every Sunday morning. Church folk ought to party. You ought to come to church to have a good time. You ought to wake up with the intention of having a good time. You ought to believe that your life is so blessed, so anointed, that God will light up your life. He can just make it what it is. You can't really make a party by having a whole lot of balloons and decorations. You can have a decorated room, but it doesn't make it a party. You can't really make a home by having a house. You can live in a mansion, but it doesn't make it a home.
Yeah.
In order for it to be a home, it has to have some love.
Yeah.
Some concern. Some care. I said, today, see, a lot of folks think you gotta have a lot of stuff to be happy. Oh, I declare to you, you can have a lot of stuff and still be messed
say
up.
Say that, say that.
I read about a lot of folks that have a lot of money, they have a lot of stuff, but they had love, they had life, they knew what enjoying life was all about. How does people have so little and enjoy life so much, and we have so much and enjoy life so little? I read about women who must have scrub boards, had to wash their clothes on a scrub board. You'd have three buckets of water, one for the washing the clothes, one for the blooming, and one for the Clorox. I don't know nothing about none of that. But they bring all that up, they have to hang their clothes up on the line. And they have never got to see about the goodness of God while they were washing clothes. All you Negroes have to do is put clothes in a washing machine and push a button, and you'd be mad about that. Don't even wash dishes, just put them in the dishwasher and get mad if you have to rinse them off first. So you try to get a dishwasher that you don't have to rinse it off. We do less and yet you're still not happy.
All right, thank
you. Real joy comes from the Lord. Amen. This joy I have, the world didn't give it to me. And the world can't take it away. I don't like your suit. That's your problem. I don't like the colors. That's your problem, not mine. You see, you can't let other folk determine the essence of your life. You have to let God define what your life is.
Right.
And so when he gets down to verse 14, he says, and we beheld his glory. And the word was made flesh.
Come on.
I like that.
Come on.
In other words, the word is just not some abstract. The word is not just something that you think about. He said the word was made flesh. The word was made into something you can see, something you can visualize. The word was made that it can actually contribute to your living, contribute to your life and to your life. He said the word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory.
Yeah.
Oh, y'all know the glory of
God.
See, you really know what God is till you see the glory of God. You see, in essence, you want to see God's glory, look around the room. Because the Bible says God created us in order to glorify him.
All right, yeah.
When I'm at my best, I'm glorifying God. When I really know what life is, I'm glorifying God. When I really know what love is and what light is, I'm glorifying God. And you see, when you glorify God, there's a liberation that happens. It liberates you when you glorify God. Because you see, when I glorify God, I then walk in tune with God. I walk in step with God. Because when you and God are walking, somebody said, order my steps.
Yeah.
Well, it's one thing when you walk in the way God wants you to walk. See, when I'm walking contrary to the will of God, I kind of find myself fighting God. And then you turn around and you want God to bless you, and you started fighting him. That's why church folk, they don't have to worry about this, but church folk got a problem with tithing. They don't want to give God his money.
Yeah.
And then turn around, God blessed me with riches. Well, how do you expect God to bless you with money, and you stealing his money?
Yeah.
If I want God to bless me, I need to walk in the will of God. How do I expect God to nurture me with love, and all I'm doing is spreading hate? That's why I got a problem with these pastors, preachers, who claim they love the Lord, they're so close to God, they don't want to kill a fetus in a lady's belly, but they don't want to do anything to help a man under that bridge over there who needs something to eat. Something is wrong with that old mentality that if I'm so concerned about life in a lady's bed than I should be, I should also be concerned about life every day.
Yeah, yeah.
I should be concerned about the home. I should be concerned about the less fortunate. I should be concerned about people who don't have all the privileges I have. But God has blessed me so that I can be a blessing. That God don't give me money so I can brag about I have more money than you. God blessed me with resources so I can use my resources to be a blessing to somebody else. And when God sees that you use your blessings to bless others, God can bless you with more because he knows if I bless you, I bless plenty.
All right.
Do I have a witness here?
Amen.
And we beheld his glory. So I'm here to glorify God today. I'm going to tell you that God is the best thing that can happen in your life.
Yeah.
I'm here to tell you that God loves you, that God cares about you, and God wants nothing but the best for you. And if you want to experience the best, walk in step with Him.
Yeah.
Because God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus the Christ. What you talking about, Haynes? All of us are children of God, but He only has one begotten Son. See, I'm crazy enough to believe that God is Jesus' daddy.
All right.
Joseph was his stepdaddy. God was his daddy. God is the one who touched Mary.
All right.
I ain't gonna tell y'all what that happened, but He touched her.
All right.
I'm here, somebody. Your daddy's gonna say amen right around that. And when He touched her, she conceived and brought forth a son. And His name is Jesus. And He gave Jesus so that anybody who has faith in Him can have everlasting life.
Amen.
So if you die and go to hell, you have nobody to blame but yourself.
Yeah.
May God bless you. May God keep you.